long before Julius Watkins became the so-called father of jazz French horn, long before he played with famous musicians such as John Coltrane, Charles Mingus, Thelonious Monk, and other jazz greats, Julius was born on October 10th, 1921, into a non-musical family in Detroit, Michigan. His parents worked as an electrician and a homemaker, and Julius was the second of four children. Julius said that when he was 9 years old, the horn chose him. Like most of us horn players, he liked the sound and fell in love with the instrument. Julius was so enthralled with the horn and motivated to become a soloist that he dropped out of high school in 1938 to focus on playing. He later told Downbeat magazine in 1961 that there was little in the way of solo repertoire for horn in classical music, so he learned to jazz. Believe it or not, his first gig was with the Ernie Fields Band on trumpet. Watkins toured with Fields from about 1939 to 1942. At that point, Denver was a city open to jazz French horn, so Watkins moved there and spent about a year there. He got married in 1943 and joined the U.S. Naval Reserve to support his family. After years of freelancing and playing with various groups, Watkins decided to go to college in 1950. He began a pseudo degree at the Manhattan School of Music in New York, which was paid for by the GI Bill. It was there that Watkins gained more notoriety and connections, so he again left school in 1953, but had many options. In 1954, he was a featured soloist on Friday the 13th, a song on a Thelonious Monk and Sonny Rollins album. Here's a short clip from this groundbreaking recording. What is it that made Watkins so unique? For one, his high range was incredible, stretching far beyond what classical musicians are called to play, even to this day. And yet, Watkins still used a beautiful tone that is representative of the best horn playing. Despite his success in various groups, Watkins was hungry for solo playing. He formed his own group, the Julius Watkins Sextet, earning special praise for his excellent tone and range. Some members of this group were Hank Mobley, Oscar Pettiford, Art Blakey, and Kenny Clarke. From 1955 to 1959, Watkins struck up a friendship with Charlie Rose, and they formed Le Jazz Modes. This was a group composed of guitar, drums, piano, saxophone, soprano voice, and sometimes even the accordion. People were enamored by this unique ensemble, and they enjoyed great success. The next big step in Watkins' musical career was meeting Quincy Jones. Jones set out to make the best band with virtuosos on every instrument. Count Basie was even quoted as telling Jones, jokingly, to not go back to Europe, otherwise he'd go out of business. Jones and the band were stranded in Europe for 6 months during the Algerian crisis, as their management wanted to leave, but the band chose to stay. They lived and played in poor conditions, with venues sometimes paying them in marijuana. Despite their hardships, the band became very close while they toured from 1959 to 1961. Here is Watkins' famous Phantom Blues solo from that era. Moving forward in time is the 1965 UCLA workshop. Watkins, Charles Mingus, and others were slated to play at the Monterey Jazz Festival, but when they got to the festival, they were only given 30 minutes to play. They decided to play their full set at a separate venue, all 2 hours worth, and it turned into this free jazz recording. According to sources, Watkins was a proud man, always with a jacket and tie. However, he battled against dental problems, liver and kidney problems beginning in the late 1960s, and diabetes. By 1968, Watkins was actually homeless. When Warren Smith, a jazz drummer, found out, he took Watkins into his New York apartment, where he stayed for about 18 months. In that time, Watkins' mental health improved, and he received more gigs, such as one with a beat poet. He also met Harriet Davison, a New Jersey librarian and violinist. They married in 1970 and 2 years later relocated to Montclair, a thriving town for jazz musicians. In Montclair, Watkins taught the young Tom Varner and Vincent Chauncey, who would go on to become jazz horn icons. Watkins' experiences had a deep effect on his music, as you can tell in this recording, called Reasons in Tonality, which was written in 1972 by Watkins for Warren Smith's group. It contains a sadness, but also some joy, some nostalgia, definitely reflected in the chromaticism and choices of harmonies. In his final years, Watkins' health problems continued to take their toll. His colleagues respected him so much that they wouldn't say anything when he missed rehearsals for health reasons. On April 4, 1977, Watkins passed away from a heart attack at the young age of 55. In a time when the first black full-time musician was allowed to join a Big Five orchestra, it was the New York Philharmonic in 1962. Julius Watkins overcame adversity and made his own path by expressing himself as a soloist and teaching others. By all accounts, he avoided the spotlight and was witty and positive despite his inner struggles. When asked about music, he said, "It's not a profitable life, but I like it." Julius Watkins was a musical force and continues to be an inspiration to people the world over.